So in 2003, reading the first human genome took 13 years. It cost $3 billion. It was an international effort. Today, you can do that same thing in a couple of hours, and it costs roughly around $1,000. And so something has fundamentally changed in these last years, which I hope our panelists will discuss and maybe come to some insight around. The technology itself has promised to reshape medicine. It's promised to reshape our relationship with the environment. It's promised to reshape our relationship with each other and even our relationship with ourselves, what we know about ourselves. That technology comes with a host of ethical problems and issues that really we don't know how it's going to turn out, and I'm hoping we're going to get some insight into that. So we have an amazing panel today. Each panelist is going to speak for roughly 10 to 20 minutes. Then we are going to have a panel discussion hosted by Heather, who's right up here in the front. And then we're going to open up the panel to questions from the audience. It should be very exciting. And now introductions to our speakers. Jason Bobe. I've known Jason Bobe for probably almost a decade now. Jason is one of the founders of the Personal Genome Project, which basically put the genomes of a core set of people onto the internet, open for research, along with various health data as well. He's also one of the founders of DIYBio.org, which is really one of the reasons why Genspace exists today. It's a forum for regular people to talk about and basically spread how to do DNA technology outside of traditional spaces. He's also the founder of Open Humans, which is an online network of people who, an online network connecting subjects and researchers to find ethical, equitable ways of sharing data. And then finally, he runs the Resilience Project, or the Resilience Lab at Mount Sinai's ICANN Institute. And I'm gonna let Jason explain more about that project. Sophie, oh my gosh, I'm gonna pronounce your name. Zaaijer, how'd I do? Yes, she comes from the Netherlands, has multiple A's in the beginning of her name. She joins us from Yaniv Ehrlich's lab at the New York Genome Center. And Sophie is working with, as I said before, some of the most sophisticated sequencing technology that's out there. She works with something called a MinION, which if you probably have never seen it, it's literally the size of a baby's fist. You put your DNA samples in there and plug it into your laptop and boom, out comes DNA information. And finally, last but not least, is Heather Dewey-Hagborg, who sort of bridges all of our communities. Heather is an artist. She works at Genspace in our lab. She also is a fellow here at Data and Society. She is a professor at the School of Art Institute of Chicago. And she works with DNA privacy, and I'll let her talk about some of her work. And with that, Heather, the stage is yours.
Dear donor T2305, I received 5 milliliters of your saliva in June. It wasn't hard to get. Using my academic email and mailing address, I simply said it was for research, genetic testing, the truth. When it arrived, I moved it quickly to the freezer to keep it fresh and alive. I sent 2 milliliters of your fluid for sequencing, and then I waited and waited and waited. 6 weeks came and went, and then another time over. The company was experiencing unusually long processing times. When the results finally trickled in 6 months later, I devoured your profile in a single sitting. You are a 46-year-old man with dark brown eyes and skin, a full head of brown hair and freckles. You toss and turn in bed, and you enjoy a savory midnight snack. You like to run for miles, for hours, and this keeps you slim, keeps your heart beating strong, and helps tame your sometimes wild thoughts. You were my first, and I think of you frequently. I imagine your face, your voice, the way you walk. I'm curious where you grew up. I worry for your health. And I wonder what you would think of me poring over your genetic details. I like to think you would be flattered, but you might be very angry. Yours truly, Heather Dewey-Hagborg. So this is the opening to an art project that I'm working on right now. It's a work in progress piece that's called T3511. And it's a project I'm working on right now as a fellow or a resident here at Data and Society. And this is a post-genomic love story and journey into molecular obsession. So this video and sculptural installation draws the viewer into an emerging world of ubiquitous genomics, DNA sequencing, biobanking, and commodification of human materials, biological materials, fluids, through the story of a biohacker's growing relationship to an anonymous donor. And the story is true, though it's still unfolding. So I wrote this letter to a stranger whose saliva I purchased online. After purchasing the saliva, I sent it to 23andMe. If anyone here is unfamiliar with the service 23andMe, this is a direct-to-consumer site company where you can pay $99 to $199 to get a kit that you spit into, send back, and then receive reports about ancestry and some medical information and some fun and quirky traits. So when I got that data back from 23andMe, I began analyzing it, going over it, imagining this person, thinking about them, thinking about what they might look like, thinking about what they might act like, and of course thinking about how they might feel about me doing this, about me analyzing their genetic material like this. And so this is something that I'd done before. So in this project, Stranger Visions, I guess it's cut off there at the bottom. So in this project, Stranger Visions, which I worked on in 2012 to 2013, I collected genetic artifacts from the streets of New York. So cigarette butts and chewed up gum and hairs and bits of fingernails, and brought those into Genspace and extracted DNA from them and analyzed that to generate these full color, life size 3D portraits representing what those individuals might look like based on genomic research. Drawing on both things that we were fairly certain about, like eye color, and then things that were really speculative, like some details of facial shape and freckling. But I wanted to take this further, and specifically I wanted to use research that this scientist named Johnny Verlich had published, showing that it would be possible to re-identify anonymous DNA donors based on guessing their last names from Y chromosome DNA data. And the backstory behind that is that after working on Stranger Visions, I was invited to give a keynote at a conference called the Bio-IT World Expo. And I thought that this would be a really great opportunity. This was like 2014. I thought this would be a great opportunity to launch my new biotechnology company, which is called Biogen Futures, and our premier product, which would be called Invisible. And this would be a kit for erasing and replacing your DNA, so wiping away and covering up DNA traces. And so I'm at this conference, and I'm introducing my product. And also giving a keynote with me there is Yaniv. And so I got to hear all about his fascinating research, which you can see I was clearly really into as I highlighted so much of this paper, and really found it totally fascinating what he was doing. And Sophie will tell you much more about that, I'm sure. So I wanted to take what I'd done in Stranger Visions further. So I'd been looking already at hints towards appearance, but I wanted to look at things beyond that, behavior, last name. But in order to get specifically to this last name part of it, I needed this Y chromosome data that that are short tandem repeats, so things that 23andMe isn't going to give you. And there is a direct-to-consumer site that does offer this STR data, and that's Family Tree DNA. And so I had an idea. The problem is that I'd bought this saliva, and it's easy enough to pour some saliva into a 23andMe kit where they request saliva in the first place. But many of the other genetic services request cheek swabs. And so I wasn't sure if this would work. It seemed like maybe this is kind of a bad hack. Can I really just dip a cheek swab in some saliva that I bought and send that back? Will that actually work? So I thought I'd try, and it worked perfectly. And so I got perfect data. And not only did I get perfect data, I got a perfect match. So the family tree DNA site gave me an exact match to this person's Y chromosome data, which supplied a guess at a last name. And then, this was surprising enough, but I was really shocked when that genetic relative emailed me and says, "Hello, I saw that we share exact DNA traits. That's pretty cool. I'm new to this DNA stuff." So in the art piece that you'll see premiering probably not for a year or so, T3511, I go into more details about sort of what unfolds in this process and what unfolds in my imagining of this person and sort of what I'm wishing and hoping for versus the reality. But in reality, this person had a very public Facebook profile. And so I ended up looking them up and sort of learning more about them that way as well, and discovering that in addition to liking cars and being religious and having children and so forth, they also lived very close to the company that I bought the saliva from. So, pretty good clue that this person is closely related to the person who actually supplied the saliva. So I was shocked at how incredibly easy it was to likely have re-identified or come close to re-identifying a total stranger from nothing more than their DNA and a bit of extra data. But I shouldn't have been surprised, because this is the post-genetic privacy world of ubiquitous genomics that we've already entered, where relatives appear out of thin air, where anonymity does not exist, where direct-to-consumer tests make genetic analysis commonplace, where mobile paternity trucks roam the streets of New York looking for customers questioning their genetic lineage, and where the criminal justice system already has a vast DNA database of 15 million records which sifts populations into those deemed of suspicion and subjects them to increased genetic surveillance, a database which recapitulates in its structure the overrepresentation of minority populations which characterizes this entire system already, and casts this gaze of suspicion beyond the individual to include also their genetic relatives, so people who happen to have DNA that's close to people in the database as well through familial searching. So already today, our biological data is being bought and sold, packaged along with the rest of our information to create increasingly detailed predictions about the details of our health and behavior, with little to no accountability or regulation. So at best, this future offers the potential of increased health and longevity. At worst, we're standing on the precipice of an age of pervasive biopower in which life itself is constantly administered and regulated and shaped in accordance with data-driven norms. So one thing that we can be sure of is that these trends are going to keep expanding and accelerating and amplifying in the next few years. And so, serving as a bit of an introduction to our next two speakers, I'm hoping that they'll take us on a detailed tour of where we're going and how.
Well, that was great. Let's see. Get this ready. So I'm Jason Bobe, and I consider myself a biomedical science producer. Which is, I like to say I'm the only one in the world because I invented the term. What I hope to do is to create organized health research studies that people actually want to sign up for. And so I'm going to start just with, it doesn't work. Okay, that was a test. Let's see. So, let's have a quick show of hands, start off interactively. How many people here are actively enrolled in at least one, as yourself, enrolled in at least one organized health research study where, like, you signed a consent form and you could withdraw if you want? Let's just hold them up high so we can see. So we got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and, like, maybe, not sure, 6. Okay, so we have, like, 6. So I don't know how many people are here, but what is that, 15%, something like that? So that's pretty common. It's actually a little higher than I thought. One of the things that baffles me is that, or one of the things that I know is by, you know, the UN went out and surveyed people in 120 countries and asked them what's important to them. What's important to you? And health and healthcare are always near the top, which is no surprise because it sort of also forms the base of Maslow's hierarchy of one of the things that you need to survive is health and healthcare. And also, if you go out and you ask people, like, who do you trust? Healthcare workers are usually near the top. Predictably, lawyers and marketers are near the bottom. And interestingly, scientists are kind of in the middle of the pile. I see the lawyer nodding his head like, yeah, nobody likes me. So health and healthcare matter, and health is valuable, and healthcare workers are trusted, yet why doesn't anybody participate in organized health research? And why is participation a fringe activity? This is something that I'm interested in solving as a biomedical science producer, because I think it's a really sad state of affairs that people don't recognize science and organized health research as a tool and the first step towards solving health challenges. Instead, typically is viewed as the last hope. If I'm dying of cancer and want access to experimental therapy, I'll join a clinical trial. Right, but health research and science applied to health is like much larger than that, and it potentially is a way for us to actually solve our own health challenges, those of our families, and know what things are effective and that kind of thing. So, and I think it's one of the most exciting times to be alive if you're interested in solving problems like that because of a lot of enabling stuff. But before I get to the sort of domestication of enabling technology for these sorts of things, I want to start with the sort of beginning in terms of just genomics research, as we're talking about the genome era. And this was the actual article that I sent off to get from the Buffalo News in 1997, where this was an article in the Buffalo News, and they had an accompanying advertisement that said, wanted men and women, or male and female, to donate your DNA. It will be put on the internet for all to see to advance humankind, yet nobody will know who you are. and it's really interesting to go back and read that, and in some ways to think about, to see how scientists in the scientific community were really thinking about this, and really in terms of privacy. Of course, you know, since 1997, When that was getting started and volunteers were being recruited to donate their saliva or blood samples to go and be sequenced for the first time, zeros have just fallen off the end of the cost. Like every year, like a zero falls off, right? Faster than Moore's law, you know, which made basically personal computing possible. The same is happening for DNA sequencing, but it's even happening faster than that. And Illumina CEO at the big JP Morgan healthcare conference just like 2 weeks ago said, our new machine, $100 genomes, probably within a year or two. So like if you just map this curve out, you get to a point where like pretty soon these machines will start just like paying you to sequence the genome, you know. So if it just continues, but the first genome sequencing devices weren't really devices; they were people powered, and there were these assembly lines of white lab coat PhDs at a place like the Whitehead Institute in Cambridge, and DNA sequencing was something that was only available to elite scientists at elite institutions. But since that, these devices have started being compartmentalized into just units. Fully contained units that even have, you know, docks for your iPhone, right? Or plug into your computer now and are disposable. And you just put your sample right there and the data goes right onto your laptop. Or Oxford Nanopore now has announced this project, you know, to plug your sequencer right into your phone, right? And simultaneously, there is the emergence of the idea of, hey, this dichotomy between researcher and human subject is starting, you know, all of our thinking about how human health research is designed depends on there being a clear relationship. I'm the researcher and you're the subject, right? And that's sort of the paradigm that exists. But suddenly there's this idea that, hey, you know what? You're not just a subject. You can be the co-investigator. You can be the lead researcher. Really, your ideas and the things that are challenging to you, you can go search them out. It doesn't just matter about the professor in the ivory tower and what ideas and questions are fundable and publishable, right? And so I think that's really exciting. And there's a larger movement, you know, out with, as Daniel mentioned, with DIY Bio. And even in the UK, you know, it's something that the teenagers are getting involved with. This is the UK Young Engineer of the Year Award in 2013. Was this guy named Fred Turner who built a, you know, essentially a DNA photocopier in his basement with a PCR machine for the bio folks in here. And of course, it's not just DNA sequencing technologies either that's making this possible, right? There are now the sort of means of production to producing knowledge and research and new sort of breakthroughs in our own health are being enabled in other ways from things like open source frameworks for launching health research studies. And so I'm always just completely gobsmacked when you actually go in and say, like, what evidence do we actually have to support our understanding about the human body, like how it works? Right? And to realize with like a disease like type 2 diabetes, which is so rampant and so common, that until just this year, the largest study that looked at the relationship between exercise and people with type 2 and blood sugar and people with type 2 diabetes and exercise was 75 people, and the study took 2 years, right? So with this sort of research kit app, they were able to set up the study, enroll 300 people in a 24-hour period, and make a new insight about what the actual relationship is, right? And so I think this is a powerful time. But I think that the bottoms-up innovation that these technologies enable are really exciting. And I'm gonna give you a few people who I look to as the harbingers of the future, you know? And so one is Hugh Rehnhoff. His daughter, Bea, I met at the White House, a really charming, delightful young lady. I think there's a documentary film being made about her right now. I know there was, a Kickstarter or an Indiegogo that was trying to fund it. I'm pretty sure it got funded. Where she had some special traits, curved fingers, things that were worrisome to her father. And he went into the medical system and said, is there some underlying problem with her heart, something I need to be worried about? And she ran into dead ends. He ran into dead ends to get answers about what was going on with his daughter. And so he set up a lab in his basement to lower the cost of the diagnostic odyssey and extracted the DNA, sent it off to the labs, got recruited scientists to be his consultants on this project, launched a website called My Daughter's DNA, and basically, in some ways, through volunteerism of the scientific community and crowdsourcing and a lot of grit, worked his way towards the identification of a causal variant that explains the symptoms around the syndrome that is affecting his daughter. And this isn't the only case like this. So Sharon Terry, despite having no PhD or MD, she has over 100 peer-reviewed publications. And she got into this unwillingly also because she had two children, both were affected with a rare disease that at the time that they were born and diagnosed with this disease, or they weren't really diagnosed, there was no diagnostic test, right, for this disease, and there was no therapy. So she went around the world and gathered up all of the people affected by this disease and said, let's find a diagnostic test and work on a therapy. And so she's been making her inroads. And along the way, been open sourcing the blueprint manual for all the other people in the world affected by rare diseases who are sort of running foundations from their kitchens. Similarly, you see one example. This is somebody I think you should look up that goes by the hashtag of We're Not Waiting. It's really a community of type 1 diabetics who are really frustrated by the information asymmetries that were sort of rampant in their disease with type 1 diabetes, where they wear these onboard continuous glucose monitors. Yet the doctors and nurses had more access to this data than they did. And this is something that the number is pretty staggering. It's something like 1 in 20 people die from hypoglycemia. And so being a parent with somebody who's affected by this disease, they could die in the middle of the night. It's not uncommon. And so you want to know, and so what people with the disease want was, I want control of the data. I want to be able to send it to my smartwatch. I want to be able to send it to, I want both me and my wife to get access to the data, those kinds of things. And so they were not getting the answers they needed. So you know what? Not only did they set up their own open source software that they could plug into the proprietary devices, this smaller community even set up their own insulin pump system that takes the data from the device and then starts helping them know when to inject insulin and control that too. So I recommend you look that up. And so I also want to spend and sort of problematize a little bit the existing existing sort of genomic research paradigm, and I'll call it trickle-down innovation, that you'll just sort of continue to wait in many ways if you want academic researchers to sort of follow, to act in accordance to your values. It's still very much there's not a sort of concept of participant-centered research like there is in patient-centered medicine. And so this is some news from the Twitter sphere. Somebody from Broad was saying, hey, this is amazing. In 2016, we sequenced enough genomes, 38,000, to fill Fenway. And that accounts for more than half of the total number of genomes that we sequenced in our whole history, which is something 60,000, right? And then my colleague, Madeline Ball, said, hey, I have a dumb, maybe sad question. How many of these people have access to their own genome data, right? And you see down there the answer says, well, approximately zero. And then explains, says, well, you know, it's not us. There's rules, and we've been told that we can't do that, right? But this is like a story that has been a very slow train wreck in many ways in the genomics community, where there was an op-ed that got published in Nature just recently, which to me was surprising that it was sort of news, like op-ed news. But a geneticist is saying, hey, I'm really worried that volunteers who join a genomics research study, we're not giving them access to their data. I mean, there's a whole marketplace, you can go pay $100 and get access to your own genome or even sequence your own genome now with these devices, but we're still got our head in the sand, we're not giving access to genomes. When people no longer need us to generate their genomes, why should they then turn around and give us their genome when we wouldn't give it to them, you know, just yesterday, right? And so I think this is a real problem with how organized health research. And so just to spend a couple minutes on some of the projects that they'll set up, maybe some of the discussion. In the context of that, I had the good fortune of working on a project called the Personal Genome Project, where this geneticist at Harvard Medical School, this is one of his favorite photos of himself, with the measuring tape on his forehead. This was one of the PGP photo booths. And he said in 2005, hey, it's time to study humans and have them be the key model organism. And he wrote an editorial and said, you know, there are two really questions that I have. One is, are people actually going to sign up to share extensive data? And two, is sharing going to cause discrimination? And so you have to remember, 2005, this was a different world. There was no genetic, there was the American with Disabilities Act, but there was no Genetic Information Non-Discrimination Act, and there was no ACA, you know, with pre-existing conditions. Now, the ACA may no longer exist, you know, as the topsy-turvy world goes forward, but the world was very different, and people's opinions about this were very unsettled, as they, I think, are still. And so in the context of, you know, this is an artwork by Bansky or attributed to Bansky, you know, in the future, everyone will be anonymous for 15 minutes, was something where we were questioning how good of an idea it was in the Human Genome Project and HapMap to signing people up to putting their data on in databases and on the internet under the idea that, oh, this is anonymous and nobody will ever know who you are. And so in the face of that, we set up a study that said, we're gonna only recruit people who are willing to forgo privacy, because what we want to do is try to set up an ideal sandbox where we could connect a bunch of different data sets and under the context where we expect that something's going to be identifiable, and that to solve some of the hardest challenges in biology, we may need to have a more holistic picture of you. Not only do we need your genome, we also need your medical records, because we don't collect DNA sequence data to really understand DNA. We do that to understand human traits, and so we need to connect all this data, right? So there are a whole bunch of unique features about the PGP, but one of the things that was really interesting was, in terms of privacy and governance, was you got access to your DNA data and then first, and then you could either run for the hills and take your data and run, or you could push the button and make the data publicly available, right? And that was the point of the study to get going. And what we found was, out of the get-go, that reciprocity is really just a powerful concept, and like people were very engaged in this research study and wanting to find ways to help. This is somebody who came to our annual meeting every year. And just so you know, that this project did create actually products that are now, if you go and get sequencing from your doctor, it's very likely that the DNA sequencing instrument is calibrated from somebody from the PGP, that there is DNA available from NIST, the National Institutes for Standards and Technology, that also has standards for like pH 7, a liquid that's a pH 7.000000, right? Things like that. And a pack of cigarettes to do flammability tests on a couch. You can buy standard cigarettes from them. But then Open Humans, just in my last minute here, is a more recent project that's now led by Madeline Ball, but basically extended that model of the PGP and added more features of not just like, you know, take the data and run or public, but then, hey, what if you actually, for all studies that are part of our research project that practice this concept of equal access and give you access to your data, then you can integrate those things over time and build a holistic data set that then you have control over who shares. You can share it peer-to-peer, you can make it public, you can give it to a bunch of different commons. There are lots of things that you can do. And we can start answering questions, more complicated questions, over time. And so those are really some projects that have sort of pushed the boundaries of privacy in biomedical research. I'm going to end with that. I'm just going to say that since Daniel mentioned the Resilience Project, I'm working on something new, and I hate to spend too much time on it tonight because it's sort of not launched yet. But if anybody's really interested in revealing potentially that they believe that they are a superhero or that they have some superhero trait, I would like to talk to you. You can come talk to me afterwards. thank you.
We want a healthy, better life, a healthier and happier life, and we can achieve that with genomics in the sense that we can have better treatments, custom-made for the individual. It's really the precision medicine initiative. But the happier life also because we want to learn about ourselves. We want to learn about our ancestry. We want to learn why we are as we are. Yeah? Why we are why we look the way we look. But that means, in order to achieve that, that means that we have to share data, that we need a lot of data of a lot of individuals in order to extract that information about the genotypes connected to the traits. And so today I'm going to tell you two stories which are connected really about to achieve this aim. We are really concerned about our genetic privacy. But I want to talk about two stories which basically are thought provocative and hopefully to start a discussion. Okay, so but the genomic field is big, and there every day new technologies coming out and new initiatives, and it's really great, but it can also be a little bit confusing because there are so many things out there. So I would like to start just to describe a little bit what's out there, and I'm just going to show you three big players which are important for the story today. And so Jason already introduced these. You have Illumina, and Illumina is a company which makes these sequencers, and you can sequence many, many genomes. You generate a lot of data. These are huge machines. You can see them over here. You need specialists in order to operate these machines. And they also they cost a lot but sequencing genomes is relatively cheap. So you also have SNP arrays, they fall a little bit in that category, big machines, but then we have the new kit on the block, and that is the MinION. And so this is a tiny DNA sequencer, fits in the palm of your hand, and you can plug it into the laptop, and you can start sequencing. And this is the device I work on, and I'm going to show you a project I've been working on, basically using this MinION. Okay, so but what are these sequencing technologies doing? And they do a lot of things, but I just want to focus on a few aspects. So Illumina is a sequencing platform that can do whole genome sequencing. And what does that mean? Because we heard that term over and over. It basically means you sequence your genome, and you don't. So that's 3.3 billion bases. You don't sequence it once, but you sequence it between 5 times and 30 times in order to be absolutely sure that you have the correct that you sequence the correct variants. Yeah. So that's in order to reduce the error rate. Now. Then you also have SNP arrays, and SNP arrays are slightly different. So SNP arrays are they look at specific loci in the genome. So those locations in the genome where it's known that there is a variation between individuals, And so those can be of interest in order to learn more about phenotypes and traits. So mostly these SNP arrays have 500,000 variants they look at. And so these SNP arrays are mostly used by these direct-to-consumer sequencing companies we heard about already. So that's like 23andMe and Ancestry.com. So they work, which was already described, so you can send your saliva and they use these SNP arrays in order to determine the variants in your genome. Now, and then we have the MinION. So the MinION is still used for research, but we predict that this is going to be a consumer product. And that's quite an interesting new angle to our old genomics field. Now, when I started with the MinION was a year ago, we could the productivity of the MinION, so in the amount of data you can generate with it, was very low. It was like 0.01 coverage of the human genome. So that's why I call it the sequencing sensor. So it's not so much really to generate really accurate reads, but more to sense and identify, and I will talk about that. Okay, but so whole genome sequencing, so we're very interested in it. You guys are all here because you're interested in genomics, and everybody knows that we need a lot of genomes in order to be able to conduct research. And why is that? So why do we want all those genomes? And so basically, I just want just a little introduction, but so we differ 0.1% from each other. So that sounds like we are very similar, but it's still 6 million variants that we differ from each other. But which variant belongs to what trait? And so we need like a lot of genomes in order to compare the genotype with phenotypes or with the traits in order to be able basically be pinpoint which variant belongs to what trait. Now, and there are many databases who do this, who basically store genomic, so the whole genome sequencing data sets from individuals. And so PGP is also there. Jason already talked about this extensively. I just have a couple. These are not all of them. But the idea is that these genomes are sequenced and put online so that scientists all over the world can access these. And hopefully these are connected with some phenotypes, not always. But they're really reference panels. And so when this started, people were immediately indeed concerned, like, okay, it's okay to have this. They understood that it was important to have your genome online and that scientists could access it, but what about my privacy? And so everybody thought really hard, and they thought, okay, let's do this. Let's say you have your genome, we put your genome online, and then we have a couple of identifiers, but we cross out your name. So there's no name, and so you don't have to worry, you're anonymous. Yeah, so just give us your genome, and you're all set. Now, that of course, it was a really good idea, and it's also that could have worked if Yaniv wasn't around. And let me introduce Yaniv a little bit for the people who don't know him. So Yaniv comes from a background where he worked in bank security systems. And so he would be hired by a bank in order to test the security systems of the banks. Now, so what happened is that the way they do that is in order to see whether, so Yaniv was going in there in order to see whether they could hack into the security system, show where the gaps were, and then report to the bank, here are your gaps. And then the bank manager could basically decide what he wanted to do about those gaps, about those security gaps. And so when Yaniv started this project where he said, okay, this looks great, but are there gaps in the security system, he wanted to be a genome hacker, but he wanted really to show that it is possible, but then let the audience be the bank managers to decide what to do with those gaps. Yeah, so it's really like just to show that it's possible, and then we can decide what we want to do with it. Okay, but he started his whole project by thinking, okay, we have a genome, and we have metadata. Maybe we can first look at the metadata and think, you know, what can we reduce the search space in order to identify this genome? So here's Yaniv, And so he said, okay, let's start with the U.S. population. U.S. population are 300 million individuals. And let's, because in the metadata it said which state this individual was from, and the individual was from Utah. So he said, okay, we can cross out all the individuals from the other state. So we reduce the number of people we are searching now in the search space. Then also the sex, you can quite easily identify that whether there is a Y chromosome or not. And so he worked with a male individual. And so you can basically cross out half of the population, right? Half is female, half is male. Then there was also indicated the age of the individual. And that reduced the search base to 20,000 individuals. At that point, he was like, okay, that's reduced, but we are not there yet. We didn't identify this individual yet. But then he continued to think, okay, we have a male individual, and males have something interesting. Males inherit a Y chromosome from their father, but they also inherit the surname. Yeah, so you have, let's say, Mr. White, he marries and he gets a son, it's called Mr. White, has the same Y chromosome, and when he again reproduces, he gets a son and also Mr. White in the same Y chromosome. And this is quite interesting, because if you know the YSTR, so there's already Heather introduced this, so these are little repetitive elements on the Y chromosome, you can basically get more information about your lineage, and this is also a direct-to-consumer sequencing company who does that. So this is the Y search. So what happens is you can indeed send your DNA material, they look at your STR, so these repetitive elements on your Y chromosome, and in the database, they then put your name and your YSTR patterns. And it's pretty cool because you can find relatives and you can look at the lineages. But in the whole genome sequencing data sets, you also have YSTRs. And so basically they started matching the YSTRs to the website, so from the genomes to the website. And now you can connect the name with the full genome. So basically this is where they were able to identify the individuals from these anonymized data sets. And so because you have these lineages, so let's say Mr. White is in the database and this is your subject, so via the lineage, the pedigrees, you can really identify who the individual is. So, and they were able to identify 50 individuals from the CEU data set. So you could say, okay, well, easy solution, let's remove all the STRs, right? All the YSTRs from the data sets and genomes, and we are sorted. Well, that's not really possible. Well, it is possible, but still you can trace back the YSTRs by looking at the surrounding locations on the Y chromosome, so you can impute them, that's how we call it. Okay, so let's remove the whole Y chromosome and just, like, you know, just cut it out and but still, we have all this other genetic material. And so we still have all these autosomal identifiers. And it's almost like it's the tip of the iceberg in order to start removing the Y chromosome. We just have to be aware of the fact that it is possible to be re-identified. And we have to think about that. Okay. So second story and project is slightly different. It has to do with privacy, but now from a different angle. So what I showed you with the surname inference are all is all data which is already generated. So we have genomic information and we have these YSTR databases. So these are all sequenced, and this is sort of closed door. Yeah? So you send your data to a laboratory, they do something with it. Yeah? So they sequence it and then they keep a copy and send a copy to you. But with Minion, now all of a sudden sequencing is at our fingertips. And so we realized that at a certain point, the Minion might be a consumer product, and it means that everybody can start sequencing. And so that also means that this has consequences for our genetic privacy. And so we wanted to ask, like, okay, can we identify individuals using this Minion device? And even though the Minion sounds amazing, it still has some glitches. So it has really low coverage data, and it has huge errors in the reads, of the sequencing reads. So we had like a little bit of a challenge there. But we thought, okay, let's see whether it's possible. Let's try it. And so inspired by Heather's work, really, we thought, okay, DNA is everywhere. It's around the city. We can find it anywhere. We can sequence. We can just go and find cigarette butts, chewing gum, and there will be DNA there. Okay, so the Minayan, like I said, it's portable. It's real-time data generation, and so you can immediately start analyzing your data when you press start. And it's relatively easy and quick to use. I will show you more detail later. Okay, so we wanted to identify somebody using the Minayan. And our first experiment is to identify Yaniv. So what did we have to do? Well, we had to get his saliva, and we had to extract the DNA. We had to prepare a library so that the Minayan actually can read it. And so after doing that, we got a plot like this, and this looks a little bit scary, but what we did, we started sequencing Yaniv, and we compared it to a database with 31,000 individuals. They all were individuals which were sequenced with the direct-to-consumer sequencing company, so like 23andMe. And Yaniv was in there too, of course. So we started the Minayan at time zero, and here you can see the time that the Minayan ran. And in the y-axis, you can see the probability of a match to an individual in the database. So you can see that in the first 5 minutes, not much is happening. There's no probability that there is a match. But after 10, 12 minutes, you can see that the probability that Yaniv is the individual we sequence is really going up. And that only requires 115 SNPs, so 115 variants. So you don't need much in order to identify individuals. So we repeated that experiment with Joe Pickrell, and we're able to do it in 3 minutes. That's pretty quick. But I'm cheating a little bit, because it's 3 minutes of sequencing. But we also want to have like the whole library preparation portable. So we want to need to isolate the DNA from the cells, and then you have to prepare a library. And we didn't want to use a standard lab, because we didn't want to have any closed doors. We want to be able to do it al fresco. So so we used the Bento lab, and actually Genspace very kindly borrowed it to us, and then we never gave it back. But that's, so I apologize for that. But it was because there was a glitch in the Bento lab. But I will show you how the whole library preparation works. So I made a little movie, how we sequenced outside, and how we were able to achieve our aim. Oh, there's no sound. Normally there is sound. Oh, yeah, no. Anyway, so so basically, Yaniv gives his, this is the New York Genome Center, the balcony. Yaniv gave his saliva, and so you start immediately with preparing the Minayan. This is the Minayan, so it's a really tiny device. Here's the Bento lab, and I started the sample prep, extracting the DNA. And it's still quite labor intensive, so it requires quite some steps. Here you can see the clock ticking, and it was very windy. Yeah, so in 48 minutes, we were able to load the Minayan and to start sequencing. And so 50 minutes. And here you can see basically you on your laptop, you can see the reads coming in. So basically we can do it portable, but still it's quite labor intensive. And you need like loads of, you need a big bag and with all your reagents and your equipment. So it's not really for anybody yet. But ONT, so that's Oxford Nanopore Technologies, who produces or makes the Minayan, also is working on making everything portable. So this is the Voltrex, where you can prepare your library, so also hands off. And so they're working on project Zumbador. And this is a project where they even allow you to do the DNA extraction and the library preparation in this little device. And so you can immediately apply that to your Minayan and start sequencing. And like Jason also showed, even the sequencing is getting more and more portable. So they make this Smidgeon, which you can just plug into your phone and can just start sequencing. And so our person identification method really could be applied in forensics, have to identify individuals at the crime scene after mass disasters where you want to be on site and sequencing everybody right away in order to identify them, at border controls in order to, instead of passports, patient samples, cell line identification, so we can use it for many, many applications. But here I would like to just, you know, be a little bit thought-provocative and think, okay, so if this is going to be like a consumer product, and maybe in December 2020, you get your Minayan under the Christmas tree, what can you do with it? Well, for instance, you can host a dinner party and just start sequencing each other, and you can sort of get like an idea what your ancestry, you know, what your roots are. And if you want to connect with your friends, you can click here, and then you can see like how many generations, how many meiosis you're away from your friend, how many traits do you have in common, and so you can sort of really explore your relatedness and explore who you are. But something else, and this is the smart toilet. So we all go to the restroom, and this guy, he's going to the restroom, and he's checking his phone, because in the toilet there is a Minayan device integrated. And he will immediately know whether his diet he chose is good. So here he is busted, because he basically ate too many burgers, and he needs to eat more veggies. And let's say that you can click for recipes immediately, some ideas, if you're, you know, and some pathogens, early detection of E. coli, maybe a little bit of a bladder infection, and so maybe recommending a doctor visit. But so this is quite nice, right? I mean, everybody would like this, because we can track our health. It's like sort of a Fitbit, but then, you know, spiced up. But what about this? What if you get like a pop-up saying Walmart celery stalks 2-for-1? You know, in order to match it to your veggies, and Bayer has now antibiotics on sale. So now we're getting in sort of on the verge where you're like, okay, so they immediately saw my information, and I get a pop-up. They read it too. They had the big data analyst who then immediately recommends products for you. So this is sort of the boundary, the tension field I want to bring up, because we want to have data. We want to track our health. We want to know what's going on in our bodies. But then we also want to maintain our privacy. And those two things are tension fields which you really have to think about, whether that is even possible. So that's why my title, We Want Privacy, But Do We Though? Because we do want to have the benefits of having all the data, sharing the data, collecting information about ourselves, and to lead a better, healthier life. So here I would like to finish. Thank you.
Okay, really great, so interesting. So when Dan invited us to do this, one of the things that he asked us to do, the very spinny chair, was to think about what our visions for the future would be. And I think, Sophie, you did particularly a nice job there at the end of spelling out how you thought that this might look and where you thought it might go. Obviously, I come from a slightly more dystopian angle, so I was thinking, what is my vision for the future? So I thought about this a bit today, and I was thinking that we're increasingly visible, right? So our bodies are increasingly being inscribed and turned into data. We're increasingly being classified and predicted. So this is sort of the way in which biodata is continuous with all of the other kind of big data issues that are so often discussed here at Data and Society. So putting people into different kinds of categories and identity buckets, and that we're increasingly predicted. So what is that data good for? It's great for predicting disease risks, perhaps, but also maybe predicting things like tendencies for criminality. So what do these kinds of things mean? And then also, what does it mean as we internalize that visibility and internalize a kind of gaze, right? So this is the surveillance question of what does it mean not just to have the government looking or have a corporation looking at your data, but also when you change your behavior because you know that you're always visible, right? And this is really this post-genetic privacy question. What does it mean to live in a post-genetic privacy world? How does that change our behavior? How does that change the way that we would interact with each other, with family, and all the rest of it? So I think maybe that's the question to start with, is how do you envision the post-genetic privacy future in terms of human relationships?
So I'm really in favor of sharing data, obviously, as a geneticist, as a genomicist. I think, so all the, so the Menaion is not meant to really generate data and detailed data sets. That's debatable in the Menaion field, but I think that's more like a sensor. So you would go to a direct-to-consumer company in order to get your genetic data, or you would go to your doctor, you would get your whole genome sequence in depth. And then you basically have to choose who you trust with your data, because the people who are going to sequence your data, they will have a copy of your data. So that's a given. And you get the copy back. And I think it's like who you trust with your data and who you think is using that in an appropriate way is a very important aspect. And then of course the whole like how I see genomics in the future. Well, I described it already a little bit. I think it should be we should share it and we should use it and we should use it to our benefit because there's so much information out there and we can gain so much from it.
Do you want to comment a little bit more in detail? I mean, this can be for either of you also, about just to sort of hone in on that, really what you think those benefits are also.
The benefits?
Of the data sharing. I mean, that's for both of you also.
Yeah, I think...
Well, I mean, I would say, let me start with the vision, then we can get a little bit more detailed. I mean, one of the things that I really hope I aspire towards is a new field of big relationships that is sort of competing with the world of big data in some ways. Because from my experience in big data is interesting, but ultimately ineffectual in many ways that matter to the things that I care about, want to see in the world. So to give you one example, in the resilience project, we did this retrospective study of 600,000 people, or really their genomes, because we didn't have access to the people. And we went out and we asked this question, hey, are there any people walking around who are adults who are carrying highly devastating, highly penetrant genetic mutations related to childhood disease? And like, wouldn't that be crazy if there was a healthy adult walking around had this, what we thought was a devastating mutation? And in the first pass, we found about 15,000 people, whittled that down to a very small list of 13 where there was DNA that could be sequenced to be sure it wasn't a sequencing error, or there was some medical record showing that we had some reason to believe that they were in fact healthy and weren't actually diseased. And so, but the story ends there, because the research scientists, where we went around and said either they gave us the data or we gave them our algorithms to do the work, they didn't have a relationship with the individual. So like one person, you know, had an AOL email address that bounced, right? Now they're on to Comcast or Verizon or Gmail or whatever. And others failed to get consent for recontact. And so we're sort of at the very early stage. So there's, you know, genomics is driven by data, so everybody's like really interested in data. But all like the so much interesting follow-up work to actually confirm anything and to get to either a preventative strategy or a therapy requires actually then working with that human being and going and saying, do you have this disease? Do you want to work with us? We're going to try to figure this out, right? And so, so in my view, the future of genomics and research is for those to be effective at actually creating new knowledge about health and finding health interventions that work, is it has to be about big relationships, more so than big data. There's only so much that you can do with the data itself. And so then it becomes a question of how do you build systems that are flexible and respond to the values of the individuals and not just to the research scientists. And so if you go back to like, you know, one of my favorite clinicians, a guy named Warner Slack, gave a talk in 1972 called Patient Power. And he was like one of the early pioneers of this idea of patient-centered medicine. He said, we should be conducting medicine according to the values of the patient, not just whatever the doctor wants to do. You know, like anyways, there's like, we're sort of at the front edge of that in the research environment. And so, but I'm very optimistic that we can sort of apply that, that as people get a seat at the table, and have agency to either ask their own questions or to really work as sort of partners in research, that that we can actually create those systems where there is privacy. And I think there's some innovative work being done out there, like SageBot Networks and how they set up databases and give flexible options for consent and things like that.
I mean, it's really amazing in a way how rare that approach is. I mean, it sound, when you describe it in that way, I think it sounds so intuitive. Of course, we want people to be fully consented. Of course, we want them involved. We want to have these really nice relationships between the people, you know, the researchers and the subjects. But it's shocking, actually, how infrequently that is the case. And even, I mean, given the research that Yaniv did, that there our regulations are so out of pace with this, and that it's still so possible, for example, to use discarded medical waste that can be re-identified as a particular person without their consent, right? I mean, and that's about as far as you can get from this patient-centered approach that you're describing, and yet there's so much advocacy away from exactly what you're describing. I mean, there was just recently, right, there was this call for comment on proposed changes to the bioethical regulations around human subjects research. And how many comments came through there where you could just see over and over again people, scientists and institutions and companies pushing back against exactly this. So how do we build support for that kind of really appreciating how important consent is and participation?
Well, I mean, I think the way to do it is by doing it. it really is, you know, right now, I keep coming back to this concept. I mean, I'm really enchanted by the history of patient-centered medicine. Partly as like, well, how do we actually create a paradigm that's sort of a participant-centered research also that's similar? And it's a little depressing, actually, to look into the history because it's so long. So this organization called Plane Tree was founded in 1978, and they set out to create an evidence-based framework for evaluating hospitals based on their patient-centeredness. And one of the criteria back then when they were paper medical records was the medical record, medical chart hung on the inside of the examination room door or the outside, i.e., can the patient access the chart in addition to the physician, right? And so, you know, fast forward 40 years later, we now have a federally protected right to access our data, but there are still sort of frontiers. And so there's a nonprofit that's trying to push this concept of open notes, because like clinicians' notes are outside the medical record, it's sort of their private notes on the records. And so people are still sort of pushing, saying, well, we should also be able to see those too. And so that's 40 years. So like, how can we, you know, have the time and double the impact in participant-centered medicine? Like, what are the levers, you know? And I think a lot of it is just doing it. And so I'm actually optimistic that there's a lot of people who care deeply about this who are involved in the Precision Medicine Initiative. And so that is a big national effort with a lot of money that aims to enroll a million people that'll be done in a way that really is a sort of testing ground for some of these ideas and takes them at a scale that we haven't seen yet. So I think that's a sort of near-term opportunity. But I should also say that I think that it's really hard to, in the current environment, on behalf of research scientists, in some ways, is that it's really hard to be a pioneer in governance as a research scientist, because the way that the system is set up with the long funding cycles and with a lot of incredible red tape that is around and processes that are around creating informed consent and IRB review and data security and all kinds of things, right? And so a lot of people are just like, well, I just want to get this project up and out and done, and so I'm going to take a template, I'm going to go push it out there, and I'm not actually going to also, in my pioneering science, I'm not also going to be a pioneering a governance inventor, right? And so that's actually one of the reasons why I'm trying to create this role of like a producer who sort of is an adjunct to scientists to take on the load of some of those things that get overlooked.
Yeah, I think initiatives like Jason is working on are absolutely great, and I think that's an example for the genomics field. But I have an example where I think there's also a problem that there are some stories out there which people heard that are not so positive and might inhibit them from joining. And actually, that's a situation where, like, 2 years ago, I was in Arizona in Grand Canyon. And the Grand Canyon has, like, really inside the Grand Canyon, so you have to walk 4 hours. So you can either get there by foot or by helicopter, and you can walk in there. There's, like, a community called Havasupai that's, like, a village. And so these people live there very secluded. So it's a very interesting community to study, actually. So Arizona State University also thought the same thing. They thought that's great. And there was also high incidence of diabetes type 2. So they went to the community and said, okay, so can we have your genetic material? And they consented. They said yes, in order to study diabetes type 2. So that was done, and so the research was performed. But then they had all this genetic material, and they were like, that's interesting. That's a lot of information on our finger, at our fingertips. Maybe we can look at a couple of other traits while we are at it. And so that happened. But then the Havasupai people heard about this, and there was a lawsuit, and they so the university had to pay $700,000. Dollars to these people. And this was really an example where people hear about these stories, and this is absolutely not how it should be. They should have been asked to re-consent and to ask whether they could be studied also for other purposes. And maybe they would have done that. But the fact that indeed researchers take the liberty to just look into anything they want is maybe not an example, and we actually should forget it as soon as possible. So maybe shouldn't even have brought it up. I think Jason is right that we should open a discussion with the participants and the researchers, and I think everybody can gain from that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yes, we'll open it up to the floor.
Does anyone have any questions?
I was one keystroke away from signing the consent form for the PGP when my wife vetoed it because something we might learn might upset our 15-year-old daughter psychologically. Does anyone have any response to that? Then, as plan B, I looked into Veritas, which is still around $1,000. But they don't do it in New York State for some reason that I don't understand.
Right, so I'm really happy that you talk to your family before you sign up for the PGP, and so it's not a requirement to get the consent of all family members to sign up for the PGP unless you're an identical twin. What's that? Yeah, it's all over the consent form. So we put it in there for a reason. Yeah, right.
You know, you could find out false paternity. I'm not worried about that.
Right, right.
I'm worried about
messing
up my daughter's head.
Yeah.
My genes.
Well, so.
Has anyone thought about that?
Yeah, so there's really good research on that. So, in terms of people's response to genetic information, Robert Greene is the one who's spent the most time studying this. He's now at Harvard, and he has the longest running ELSI study, ethical, legal, social issues, for this reveal study, where I forget how long ago it's been now, but maybe 10 years ago, he got funded to show people their Alzheimer's mutations that predispositions towards Alzheimer's, asymptomatic people, and say what happens. Because at the time, people were really worried of giving access to this kind of DNA information because people would jump off of bridges. The fear of that. And what they found that there was one trait that was predictive of having anxiety from genetic information. Do you want to guess what that is? Anybody want to guess what that trait is? That, what's that? No, nope. Nope.
Not knowing.
Not knowing, right.
Huntington's?
No.
Anxiety.
So if you were anxious before you got the genetic test, had an anxiety disorder, getting the results would cause you to have an episode that would inflame your existing anxiety problem. But for everybody else, even bad news, and in some cases, surprisingly, was welcomed. And being like, oh, well, this is great. I learned something new about myself. I can now, like, buy long-term care insurance. I now know more. I can plan my life accordingly. And so it was surprising that people were actually... and then he actually took it further and then went back and was retested people's response over time, over different periods, and also found that people who got bad information, after a number of time, unrelated to Alzheimer's, they just forgot that they even got bad news. It was like, it wasn't even a thing. They were just like, they're on to their next thing, and it wasn't an issue. So that's where you can start. Yeah, you got it. So that's one place to start looking.
So I think this is also the question of the sort of what can we do question, right? If we're saying the genetic privacy is basically impossible, we're entering an era where anyone can walk around and sequence your DNA, we're going to have these little sequencers, it can happen all the time, you're going to have all your medical data, you know, there with all the DNA in it, right? So what you're talking about is a really preliminary question at the origin point of something that's going to become so commonplace. And so it's a really important question. I'm getting there. I'm building towards it. So the point is that it's a really important question that isn't really being discussed enough, and it's a really hard one to answer. And the closest that I've come, I mean, this is something I've thought about quite a lot. So there are, of course, initiatives around policy. But it seems to me that the most important thing is really hands-on education, because what you need to understand are the limits of what this technology is actually saying. I think anyone who would look at this genetic information and see it as a death sentence in that way, I mean, that would be almost never the case. And so, of course, there's a role there also for genetic counseling and for having these kinds of interventions, which is why these things are not legal in New York State, because the idea is that you shouldn't just get your data and then interpret it on your own. You should have an expert there to help you interpret it. So that's why this data is hard to acquire from these direct-to-consumer services in New York State. But really, I think what we need are more places like Genspace, where people can go in and work with the stuff of biotechnology and really understand how incredibly limited it is.
Could I add one thing to that? I forgot. I also have a GitHub repo. I'm collecting letters to family members about your interest in sharing genetic information, where you could go look to, like, that I would encourage anybody, if you're going to share your genome with research, and you want to write a letter to your family, be like, this is why I'm doing it. You could go copy one of these letters or add your own on my GitHub repo. So I would encourage that. But also, I don't think it's necessarily materially different from talking about health conditions that run in your family. Like, why is mom sick? Why is Uncle Bobby sick? Right? I mean, it's a similar conversation with your children that I would, one of the newsletters that I signed up for, I have two kids, was just saying, I have cancer, how do I talk to my kids about that, you know? And, like, there's resources out there for, like, communicating with your children about this. I would be interested to know, there may be resources out there, too, about, you know, talking about genomic information or specific mutations.
What's your GitHub?
Jason Bobe.
Hi, I have a remedial question because I'm new to all of this, and then I have a dystopian theory to bounce off of you guys. So the remedial question is there any standardization about which traits are acceptable to be self-reported from subjects and which ones need to be independently verified? Such as, like, I can tell that my pee smells like asparagus, but I might think I'm an awesome sprinter, and really, I'm kind of lame. Like, is there any kind of standard for that?
Well, so there's some interesting history on that. I know one study where Ken Mandel at Children's Hospital went and said, you know what, let's run a test. We're going to ask who can do a better job, a treating physician in an emergency room or a mother of an infant, and to tell about the dehydration of the infant. Mm. And so they went and they had a bunch of babies come in that had potentially dehydration, and then they just saw how the doctors did, and privately they asked the mothers about whether or not they thought the babies were dehydrated. And the mothers beat the doctors. And so this is a published peer-reviewed article. Now that isn't like the case that makes the rule, but in terms of I think there's definitely skepticism of self-reported data that is diminishing, particularly around chronic diseases where there is no better expert about what you're experiencing than you, and in many cases. Now, that's not to say that you're the expert on the what's happening at a molecular level, but in terms of like your symptoms and the things that are happening, like you are the best expert. So I think the world sort of caught up to that. But in terms of scientific research, it's always a question about how quality is your, like how high a quality is your data, and whether or not people are likely to know or to have high quality information about some self-assessment. I think that's always.
Yeah, and I mean that's also why we need a lot of subjects. So you want to have a lot of people self-reporting. So it's not like, you know, one person says he's an awesome athlete, and we're like, okay, so the variance in that genome is like, you know, that's it. So we need loads of people who are self-reporting, and then that's sort of like the concept of big data, where if you have so many people who report something specific, not everybody is going to exaggerate. So, you know, some people will address it properly and some people will underestimate their own abilities in sprinting. So that's sort of, that's why we need also so much data in order to be able to say that, yeah.
Oh, can I ask? I'm also in a sleep study right now. I like to sign up for studies because I like to figure out like what's working and what's not, and basically how they suck, because they mostly suck. But the sleep study is pretty awesome because it has a bunch of technology. And so this is like data scientists getting into the sleep and saying, you know what, we're not going to trust like your diary of sleep per se. First of all, nobody like fills those out or wants to or has the time. So we're just going to like put 5 sensors on you, one under your bed. I have wearing a ring, a watch, a shirt that I wear at night that has a monitor that tells my sleep position, you know. And so so what is common where they can is you measure it in 5 ways. You know, and then you sort of hone in on them.
Okay, and then quickly, my crazy theory. Do you guys see any possibility with this portable ease of use sequencing? Is there such a thing in the future as like a repro man or a bounty hunter who's just has some kind of financial incentive to fink out other people and they somehow get access to their info? And
I mean, it's an interesting question because indeed we have our DNA, I mean, Heather's project really touches upon that. Our DNA is out there. Yeah, we secrete it every single day when we walk through the street, when we go through the subway, Chris Mason's work, where he you know, is able to analyze what ethnic backgrounds are in what subway stations. And I think that it is possible. Having said that, you always need reference files. So you do need to have access to files where the person is actually present, or a family member. Or so, you know, it's not that they can just go out there and sequence everybody and identify everybody. You do need like a reference file, a database, similar to what CODIS is. Heather briefly mentioned that. So FBI has like a whole database with DNA profiles, which are connected to a name, and you can, that's how they use it at the moment in order to identify individuals. You do have, it's not that you just can go out and sequence and see where everybody is, and you need to do the bounty hunting. But it's interesting, I mean, it's an interesting application.
But I kind of disagree with that, actually, because as I told her my story, it was actually pretty easy to figure out who this person was from their DNA. So I think it's certainly not that you could find everyone right now, but that we'd have to just try and see how many people we could find on the subway. I mean, how many of these people are connected to people that are in databases that we could access?
So two quick notes on this. So one is I sort of assume there's going to be a global family tree that's public, and that's just like a reality of the future. And because where you don't have somebody, you can sort of impute the people in between and get that. And some people actually believe that this will be a great social benefit of having this. So A.J. Jacobs, I went to his festival, the Global Family Reunion, where, you know, his premise, he wrote all these funny books of A Year of Living Biblically. He lives in Brooklyn. And he sort of is one of the prolific self-experimenters where he, like, does something for a year. He tried to follow all the rules in the Bible, you know, so the cover is him, like, dressed as Moses with a sheep and a staff, like, walking through Times Square. He thinks that if we all thought of each other as cousins, which we are, but maybe like ninth cousins, that we would have fewer problems in the world. And who's to say that he isn't right about that? If we were to actually think that we were, recognizing the sort of connectedness of each other more. What's that? Cain and Abel. Okay. So one other, so to go the other direction, if you don't believe that, there are policy remedies, right? And some of these are floating in the United States. There's one up for debate in Australia right now that basically says re-identification is a criminal offense, and to start to make to criminalize it and say if you are taking anonymous samples, if you are trying to re-identify anonymous data, then that is, it's sort of like hacking into the bank. Like, you can't do that. I'm sure there are going to be lots of caveats, into that. And maybe there will be some things that are victims to that, because on the one hand, before Heather, there was also in 2008, I think maybe there was it was 15-year-old who re-identified as anonymous sperm donor father, right? Because he had a couple pieces of information and he had his own saliva and sent into Ancestry, and then like found a match, and the match he found turned out to be like the uncle or brother of his dad, and then like made his way back and showed up and said, "Hey, Dad," to the anonymous sperm donor, right? On the one hand, you say, "Whoa, that's crazy, scary." On the other hand, it's a story of reunion, right? And so he re-identified somebody that wasn't supposed to be, but he re-identified a family member, and so maybe that should be criminal. Maybe it shouldn't. I don't know, but there are remedies.
But I think though that policy one is so short-sighted. I mean, for specifically, you had the slide of DIY bio up there. I mean, if you have this sequencer in your kitchen, we're going to have these kinds of over-the-counter devices. It's going to be pretty straightforward to do a paternity test, kind of matching test, I think, in the privacy of your kitchen. So this question of will policy be able to stop that, I don't think that it will. And also, I think in terms of this, of course, it's a very nice idea that we would find out that we're all connected and that we all love each other and no more fighting anymore and stuff. But if the Human Genome Project is any indication, upon the completion of that, right, we were told we're all the same, right? We have all the same DNA, basically. There's no such thing as race, all these kinds of things. And then so quickly, we started looking at those tiny variations and figuring out, how do we make race happen again in the genome by looking at these kinds of variations and split people apart. So that's one part of it, is this resurgence of categorization, which the Ancestry workshop next week will go into. And then also, sometimes, we all love these stories where you get your ancestry analyzed and then you find out you have some, far-flung bits and pieces that you've never had any idea about. But I think also more often than not, you're going to find out that you are what you thought you were. And that's not necessarily going to bring you closer to anyone who's different than you.
Can I ask a question? It's related. But I think we should pass it around because
Oh, I've been waiting so long.
No, not the
same person.
Sorry, I forgot.
Not in the same position.
Independent.
Okay, so I'm just thinking about the smart toilet. And I suspect I might know the response. It seems like there are two camps here. But I'm just thinking about the glass room that was in Soho, where there was this idea of privacy literacy, that we have to inform the public about their data leaking all over the internet. And everybody was upset about GPS, and oh my God, you can find where I am, and now it's in our phones and we don't care. So I'm just wondering, I think I might be more in your camp, but I've been doing research on wearable technology, and I'm finding out more about how wearables are moving toward measuring blood and saliva and sweat, and that gives you all this great information about your health, and you can be tracking your moods by the like skin galvanics and things like that. So that click, click, gimme, gimme, I want that. Sounds like we're gonna start going, I'm wondering, I guess my question is, do you see a future where the smart toilet attached to Walmart really is coming quickly, or were you just like way out there without imagining, because you're the fish in the sea, and I'm trying to understand how the currents are flowing. Like, are we moving toward this? Everybody's gonna say, yeah, I don't care, sure, take my DNA. I wanna know whatever so, I wanna so know.
Is the question like, is it possible, or is the question,
it sounds like it's possible, but do you think it's coming quickly? Do you think that
it's connected to sort of, well, the thing is that I think it would help genomics greatly because people do stuff when they get something back. And it's also the whole thing with big data. So we want to get stuff from the internet and because that benefits us. And people use the data and force advertisements upon us or you know. Do it. So there's always like a give and take in that field. And I think the smart toilet would definitely help for the genomics field in order to give something back to the user. So basically you get direct feedback of your health system. Now, would it be accurate at the moment with the current research? I mean, that's debatable, what kind of data you get and how accurate it is and whether we can extract DNA just like that in a toilet bowl. And I mean, there are a lot of caveats to the whole idea, of course. But I definitely think it's in the future could be possible. To your other question, like, is it okay to connect it to Walmart? Well, maybe if Walmart starts investing in this type of... that's how simple it could be. Yeah? If they start investing in developing these kind of toilets, then they also want something back. So there's always, like, this back and forth. Also money-driven in the end. I mean, the DTC companies, there's 250 out there. That's it loads. I mean, some are very tiny, and they give some give... they test your genetic material and they give you a report back where, you know, a lot of scientists frown, like, how can you even report that? But that's all, you know, money-driven. People, if they can do it, they do it. And so, you know, there's that aspect too. I mean, this is more like really for the consumer part of it. So I'm not talking about scientists, you know, in science, and I think it's completely different. But I mean, there is an aspect where, yeah, it's sort of a capitalist world where people want to make money. And we want also things. We want products. We love the Fitbit. We want to have as much information about ourselves as possible. So we feed each other. Yeah.
So I'm a techno-optimist. I'm not particularly scared of the future that's been described. And I actually find kind of the history of humans being scared of technology that's just around the corner really interesting. So for example, when cars were coming out, people were really scared about a future where you didn't have this horse that you loved. And people went as far as to create a law where you had to dismantle your car, hide it behind a bush so that horses could go by, and then you would reassemble it, and then you could drive off again. And people were scared that recorded music would destroy the music industry. But it turned out it actually created the whole thing. So I would like to balance it out and ask, like, what are some of the like really interesting things that you think are going to improve society beyond perhaps just like solving some diseases? Like, what are some interesting commercial applications? Or like, what are the things that get you excited about this beyond just like the gist of like really fascinating scientific research?
Making evidence-based decisions about my health. I mean, like, every day. And, like, the basic stuff. Not the catastrophic illness, but, like, what is this
diaper rash, and which ointment should I use, and why? You know, like all of that stuff, and you know, ways that will radically improve my quality of life, of just being able to avoid illness and increase productivity and happiness, and in my family, in is what I really see, and that's going to require somebody to come in and set up like a trust framework where, you know, you can have the sort of Waze app for your health, and like, you know, the routes to health and the routes to illness, and you can like stay on track, you know, and those possibilities only happen with lots of people signing up and saying like, I want to know, and so I'm gonna put my data in. But you got to build that system that people do that.
Yeah, like I have to say, like, the shit bit idea is kind of awesome. Like, I like the idea that it would analyze that, and it couldn't help it when you said Fitbit and then showed that. It just, but I find that really exciting, the idea that it can figure out what you've been exposed to the end of the day. That seems to me like a really good thing. And I think, like, people are also worried that computers would take away all the jobs, and like, that hasn't happened, you know? And so, like, I kind of interpret it as like, and so like, sure, it seems like automation may be around the corner, but like, throughout history, like, technology creates more jobs than it destroys. And so like, I can't help but feel like this is really important, and I'm really looking forward to it. So I guess it's more of a statement than a question, but I don't know, I just wanted to balance out the dystopian point of view we've heard a lot of.
Who has a say?
Well, we all live in a system, right? We, like, I didn't get to decide that we all had to wear clothes. That's just kind of the world I was born into.
Can I just say, like, one last thought? Is that okay? It's just, like, super quick. Like, who are we?
It's easier to hear you.
I can talk loud, but okay.
Like, who are we sitting in this room, and who will not be able to access their information? And there's going to be, like, a huge gray area before this utopian future. We really need to think about living in that. Like, who are these people gonna be that can't access their information, but other people have it? And this is already where we are. I think we really need to leave, like, thinking about that, thinking about what we as people can do now to make it more just.
Equitable.
Yeah.
That's a nice note to end on.
Beautiful. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, our panelists.